Good evening, church family. How we doing?
Amen.
That was like five of y'all. It's not Sunday morning, and y'all are allowed to get, you know, out in church. So are y'all doing okay? Amen. All right, so look, this evening, it is a great pleasure to have Johnny and Megan in the house with us. Will you put your hands together? Yeah. In worship, and then we also have Dr. Manley with us tonight, which we are super excited about. Dr. Manley, thank you for being here. If y'all put your hands together. I'm going to open us in prayer, and then I'm going to let Johnny and Megan do what Johnny and Megan do, and that's to usher in the Holy Spirit in this place. We feeling good tonight?
Yeah.
Heavenly Father, God, we love you, and God, we thank you. God, we thank you for moments like these where we can come into your house and worship you freely. We thank you for moments like these where we can come in and encounter you in such a real and tangible way. And God, I just ask in this space during this time that you will do things that only you can do, that you will move and speak in a way that only you can move and speak. We are here tonight to encounter you, Jesus.
Yes.
It is in your name we pray, in the beautiful, powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, what's up, Nacogdoches First Church in Nazarene?
Yeah.
We're going to be back in a Nazarene building. Baptists don't do that. And by that, I mean clap. in fact, anything with their hands, they just, I think they're sitting on during worship. So you're already 10 steps ahead. But it's good to be with you this evening. We've been praying about this weekend for months, since like January, I think. And so it's good that it's finally here. Hey, real quick before I keep going, you haven't met somebody who's really special to me. This is my wife, Megan Hughes.
Yeah!
Many of you have been praying for her for 30 years. Some of you not quite that long, but hey, we'll take all the prayers we can get. And hey, we made it, so that's awesome. That's an answer to prayer right there. And she hasn't gotten so many of you yet. We're cutting in and out a little bit, I think. How are we doing? Can you still hear me?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, good deal. We'll make it work. And also, I've been so excited to see this man down here. Ever since I heard that you were coming, Stephen, man, I was like, I gotta get there for that weekend. So I was like, Joe, please let me play so I can be there. And the last time I was with Stephen Manley was 12 years ago in his home, 11 in Tennessee. And I got to see him in his community and in his church and with his faith family there. And oh my goodness, you're in for a treat to hear this man preach, to hear him speak about Jesus, to be in the room while he's in relationship with the Father. We get to benefit from that together. So buckle up. I can't wait. Okay. Let's talk about something real important. By the way, I'm one of those worship pastors who everybody says, would you just shut up and sing? And my answer is no. Because we have something important. We're singing about eternal things. And so if we're going to sing about eternal things, then we need to understand why we're singing them. We can't just take these things for granted. We can't just go, this is nice Christian-flavored entertainment. Leave that attitude way out the door. We've got to say things that are true about Jesus, and we need to say things that are true to Jesus together. And the mode that we're going to use to do that is by singing. And singing is one of those things that we do a lot in church, and we just don't ever really ask why. But in fact, singing is something we are commanded to do throughout Scripture. I believe it's like 72 times throughout the New Testament and the Old Testament that we are commanded to sing. Not if you feel like it, you know, make some noise with your mouth. And not if you're in the right mood, then okay, you might think about singing. No, we're commanded to sing. And though God never explicitly says exactly why that is, I have a few ideas of what that might be. As a singer, when I was trained to sing, I was taught that I'm supposed to open up my lungs and open up my throat and open up my mouth as wide and as deep as I could so I could let all of this air in. And then whenever I sing correctly, I leave all of those places open so that it can all exit in a way that resonates pleasantly. So what I think, one reason why I think God might be asking us, commanding us to sing, is that when we inhale with the preparation to sing, man, we're cutting out bad.
we do that, oh yeah, we're gone now.
Check. When we do that, we are allowing the true things in the world about God to invade every cavity in our body. We're allowing the truth about God to come into our lungs, into our mouths, and then to exit so that others can hear those things. We're letting the ultimate praise of the God who made us come inside of his creation and come back out so that others who have been created can benefit from that praise, from that testimony. So Paul wrote to the Colossians and he said, "Let the message about Christ in all its richness fill your lives. Teach and counsel each other with all the wisdom he gives. Sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts." So tonight we're going to start this evening by doing something that I think you've probably sung this song, I don't know, 1,000 times. So that you can practice the whole opening up your lungs and opening up your throat and opening up your mouth and letting praise indwell you and then leave you. So that others around you can benefit from that testimony. We're going to sing a song that I know you know. So why don't you stand to your feet and we sing together now. And hang on, can I get just a little bit of Megan's mic in the notes, please? Say. Okay, real simple. Goes like this.
Thank you. Thank you.
said, sing songs and hymns and spiritual songs to God with thankful hearts. I think that's where praise begins. Recognizing all the things that we do have to be thankful for, and then turning back around and saying, God, thank you so much for all that you've done, all the ways that you're beautiful, all the ways that you've loved me, all the ways that you've provided, the ways that you've never left me all my own. Well, as I think about all the things that I'm thankful for, well, this weekend, Megan and I have gotten to hang out with my brother and my sister-in-law, and they have two little ones now. Max is 3 years old, and his little sister, Ellie, is 7 months, just like I thought. 7 months. So Max is he's a ball of energy, y'all. He's a lot of fun. I think they're still Cardinals fans, but the reason they were Cardinals fans was because J.J. Watt was there, so that might be a little bit outdated. But Max is still a little ball. So Brendan is now a police officer, for those who don't know. And he works late in the evenings most of the time, but on one particular day shift, he came home and Max was waiting for him on the front porch. And this is a picture of what happened whenever he got there. He's pretty stinking cute. But did you happen to notice what happened whenever Max caught eyes of his daddy in the driveway? Those hands shot straight up in the air. Now, this is something we talk about a lot. I don't know about y'all's church, y'all might be better about this. Like I said, Baptist hands, none. Maybe you're better about this, but I like to teach about it because it's something that's in scripture, it's something that we in Christian culture talk about, but maybe we don't know why we do it. That's why. Because that posture is not the posture of a person who's got their life together, a person who's totally sufficient in and of themselves to provide for all the needs that they have. That's the posture of a person who needs to be picked up, needs to be held, needs the attention of their daddy. Max knows that he's safe in the arms of his father. He knows that he's cared for, he knows that he's loved deeply, even more deeply than Max can fathom there in that moment. And so his response is, pick him, daddy. Let's go play. Let's go sit in your chair and let's watch Star Wars. So when we raise our hands, same picture, even greater depth of total dependence on the one who alone is able to satisfy every need and every desire that we have. This is the posture of human beings, of God's kids, God's little boys, God's little girls, totally in surrender to their Father, saying, God, whatever you have in store for my life, I trust you. I know that you care for me beyond anything that I can fathom. And so I'm gonna put my hands up in the air, not because I need to show anybody how holy I am, but because I need to recognize with my body how holy and how good and how sufficient you are. Right. So we're gonna sing a song about thanksgiving, gratitude, and praise. And I don't want you to just sing along because the words are on the screen. I want you to sing along because God's stirring in your heart because of all the ways he's come through in the past. You can recognize that. You can be grateful for that. And as you're grateful for what he's done in the past, what you've seen him do in scripture, well, then you can put your hands up and you can say, God, I trust you. I put my life in your hands. I believe that you care for me. I want to be held by you, Father. Will you join us? Let's sing.
Thank you. Opportunities to share together like this. So we're going to be looking at Acts chapter 5 and especially going into verse 28, but especially verse 29 down through verse 32. So that section of scripture I'd like for you to concentrate on with me during these 3 days. And what I'd like for you to do is, as we share about it and get into the passage and get the feel for it, that you would maybe have this, maybe do them in your own, go over this passage in your own devotional time. That would be neat. Maybe God will speak to you and tell you something rich about the passage. You can come and share it with me, and I'll preach it across the country, and people think I'm great. So that's the plan. So we're looking at Acts chapter 5, verse 28 down through verse 32. This is the largest story in the whole book of Acts. It starts clear back in chapter 3, and it centers on a guy, we don't even know his name, but he's known as the lame beggar. We do know his age. He's over 40 years of age. The scripture is very specific about that. He's over 40 years of age, and he's been begging all of his life. He's not somebody that came down from Chicago, and we don't know whether he's crippled or not. No, we were there when he was born. We cried with his parents. He's been crippled all of his life. And he has assumed the begging position. He's outlived everybody else who's been begging at the Gate Beautiful. And so now he's got the top spot. And he's there during the most populated time. The Gate Beautiful's where everybody comes in. There's probably about 25,000 people that come through that gate in the evening time of prayer and sacrifice. So he's there. He's been there. He continues to be there. Jesus walked by this guy. No miracle. Peter and John walked by this guy, no miracle. But this time, timing is everything. Timing is everything. Wouldn't it be something if this is your time? Timing is everything. Peter and John walked by this guy, grab him by the hand and yank him to his feet and say, in the name of Jesus, and the guy is made totally well. Luke goes crazy with the words. He uses about 7 different words to describe this guy. What happened to him? Wasn't just his ankle bones were made strong and he could walk, but all the way through, can you imagine the abuse he's experienced, the psychological scars he has? You understand he's been ostracized from the temple. He's never been allowed to go in the temple because he's handicapped. He's been cut off of all redemption. He's never offered a sacrifice. He has no relationship with God. How could he? He can't even go in and celebrate with the people of God. He is out. And he's gone through all of this abuse. And Luke uses all these words to talk about how God, literally, from, yes, physically, but mentally, spiritually, emotionally, has made him totally, absolutely whole. And he's dancing up and down. He's walking, leaping, praising God. And he grabs a hold of Peter, like, if you get away, Peter, my miracle will go away. Like, Peter's responsible. So they come into the temple. They're at Solomon's porch, where the early church did a lot of its services and had a lot of miracles going on at Solomon's porch. So they've come into Solomon's porch, and it acts like a wave that goes throughout all the temple as the 25,000 people that are there begin to realize this guy has got a miracle. And they all come. And they all stare at Peter, and the lame beggar who's been healed's got a hold of Peter. Again, like, you're responsible. And Peter is horrified. He begins to realize that they're accrediting this miracle to him. And they are absolutely horrified. He is absolutely horrified. He turns to the crowd and says, guys, whoa. And he begins to give an exhortation. The exhortation is basically, hey, Listen, I'm just like you. I put my pants on one leg at a time like you do. Want to smell my feet. But I am just like you. So don't accredit. No. This all came about by the man called Jesus. And he begins to proclaim the overwhelming greatness of the person of Jesus. Now, this has upset. It's been getting that way. It's been moving in that direction. All the services, all the people that are claiming the name of Jesus, all that's going on, has finally, and this kind of tips the scale, you know, and persecution is about to be launched. So here comes the 70 most powerful men of Israel. They're the council. They come bursting through the crowd. They separate the crowd, come right up to Peter and John, and the lame beggar's been healed. And they literally grab a hold of them and shut the service down. Still, 5,000 men got saved. Didn't even get to give an altar call. Oh, it was a powerful service. So they drag them down to, in the jail, it's by the court. Because it's evening time. Leave them there all night and get them out the next morning. The next morning, they interrogate them. They interrogate them And Peter is given a chance to respond. And what is the interrogation all about? When it's finally boiled down, I really want you to get this, when it finally boiled down, the only thing that this council, you understand, the council, the Sanhedrin, 70 most powerful men of Israel, these are the politicians, the religious leaders, they hold life and death in their hands. These guys are educated, wear double-breasted suits, go to operas, write fat books. That's these boys. They lead schools. They're sophisticated. They're over here are the apostles. Now the apostles are from up north, Galilee. They are fishermen. They are uneducated. They read comic books. They listen to country western music. So that, see, you got this. These guys have the power to bring every. Hey, they nailed Jesus. We can take care of you. That's no problem. So that's the scene. What is it that this group of the 70 most powerful men of Israel, what is it that this group is upset about? It's not miracles. See, they say to the disciples, we don't care whether you do miracles or not. Hey, it helps the welfare program. We're great. We're glad for it. So help yourself. We don't care. We don't care if you have suppers. Cook the hamburgers. We'll eat them. It's okay. We don't care about the supper. We don't care if you sing. We don't care if you raise your hand. We don't care if you have services. We don't care if you have Sunday school. We don't care if you do compassionate ministry. You can get free pizza to the teenagers. We don't care. You can go on having service. You can do anything you want to do. We don't care. The only thing we're going to require of you is shut your mouth about Jesus. Don't want to ever hear his name again. I want him eliminated. Don't teach. Don't preach in his name. Don't teach in his name. Teach, hey, anything you want to teach. Teach baptism. Teach church organization. Teach be good. Teach against drugs. Anything you want to do. We don't care, but shut your mouth about Jesus. That is the only thing we're requiring out of you. Keep still about Jesus. Do you know how significant that is? Now, be sure you get this. When we say keep still about Jesus, we're not talking about data about Jesus. We're not talking about information about Jesus. We're not talking about the church of Jesus. We're not talking about the book of Jesus. We're talking about the living, functioning, moving person of Jesus. We're not talking about the idea of Jesus or the concept of Jesus. See, you can preach about the Messiah. We don't care. But just shut up about Jesus. We cannot stand the person of Jesus. Eliminate him from the church and everything will be all right. Don't ever talk about the person of Jesus ever again. I think it's really, have you thought about this? That you could travel all over the world and people all over the world mash their thumb and you know what they scream? Jesus! I have never in my entire life heard anybody, Buddha! Mohammed! There's got to be a reason for that, folks. In the spiritual world, in the demonic, angelic, spiritual world, nobody gives a rip about Buddha. There's no significance in Muhammad. What is the issue in the spiritual world? It's this. It's this Jesus. It's this Jesus person. This living, functioning, moving person of Jesus. We can tolerate anything. You can talk about any God. You can stand on the street corner and in God we trust. But when you bring up Jesus, that is so. Eliminate Jesus.
Jesus. That's the only thing we're asking you to do. The apostles, and they turned him loose. After they told the apostles, Peter and John told them that, they turned them loose. The scripture says they went back to the early church. Don't know how many were there. They gathered them all together. So they gathered all the early church together. And it very specifically in the book of Acts tells you that Peter and John stood before the congregation of the church and said, folks, and they told them all, they didn't hide anything, didn't sugarcoat it, told them all that had gone down and all the threat that they were facing. And said, if we talk about Jesus, they're going to do to us what they did to him. What do you want to do? They had a prayer meeting. When they got done with the prayer meeting, it says that the place where they were abiding was shaken at its core. And they went out of there, and with greater boldness than ever before, talked about Jesus. Just couldn't keep still. Now, that went on for we don't know how long, a couple months. So in great boldness, they're proclaiming Jesus. In fact, towns outside of this is all located right here in Jerusalem, you understand. And it's all among the Jews. So some towns outside of Jerusalem now are coming in and experiencing Jesus in their lives. And the thing is growing. And so finally, when you come to our chapter, you find out that the high priest and especially the Sadducees say, we can't take this anymore. They didn't. So the second phase of persecution, they've already brought Peter and John in once. Now this time, they're going to bring in all the apostles. All 12 of them are going to be drug in. And they put them not in the special jail by the court. They put them in the common prison with all the riffraff of the community. So can you see these guys? They're in jail, locked down in the common prison. That night, an angel of the Lord gets them out. He comes and releases them from the jail. Now that's interesting because the Sadducees, who are behind this, well, basically behind this, the Sadducees don't even believe in angels. So in the passage, it's really downplayed. But the angel of the Lord came at night and got them out. And isn't it interesting? The angel, think about this. The angel turned to these guys, the apostles, and said, listen, sneak out of town. No. The angel said, I've released you for safety. No. You know what the angel told him to do? Go back down to the temple and start talking about Jesus. Well, what was the point of getting us out? Because if we do that, well, wouldn't it be interesting if Jesus doesn't give a rip about your happiness? What if he has a divine plan and he's asking you to fit into it? Well, if it includes me being good looking and having lots of money, I'll buy it. What if it's a foot by jam with a bleeding back? What if this is not about your pleasure, folks? What if this is not about, oh, I'll heal you, I'll take care of your ingrown toenails? What if this isn't about that? What if this is about a divine dream and God is releasing you for the purpose of the divine dream? So they're released. They go back down to the temple, start talking about Jesus. And of course, the Sanhedrin gets together. They aren't even aware of this. The Sanhedrin gets together, says, get out of the jail, get these guys. They go down there. The guards are standing there, like, unmoved. And the doors are locked, like they've never been unlocked. And finally, when they get in, the apostles are gone. They come back and tell the Sanhedrin, and the Sanhedrin, these 70 men, the council, they get scared to death. What on earth? Because they heard about the miracles. What on earth? I mean, they got out of town. What are they going to do to us? And then suddenly somebody shows up and says, well, they're down at the temple preaching Jesus. Well, go get them. So they went down, drug them down before the council, and that's our scene. They are now before the council for the second time. Now, if you look at verse 28 of chapter 5, you will see that the council says to them, did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? And look, You have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine. You intend to bring this man's blood on us. Again, the whole issue is Jesus. Did we not? The only thing we ask of you, don't talk about Jesus. Now, I want you to notice in the passage, and you can research this in the other scene of persecution and what the Sadducees and Pharisees are into. But do you know in verse 28, they never mention, this is the council now, the Sanhedrin, they never mention the name of Jesus. Look at it. Verse 28. Did we not strictly command you not to teach in this name? But they won't mention the name. And look, you have filled Jerusalem with your doctrine, which is Jesus. But they wouldn't mention the name. And you intend to bring this man's, but not Jesus. See, in fact, it's interesting that if you go back to the Talmud, which is the commentary of the Old Testament in that day, the time we're talking about. If you go back to the Talmud, which again is the commentary of the Old Testament, and give something of history along with it, whenever they came to the person of Jesus, they called him the so-and-so. They can't stand the name! We want to eliminate Jesus. Get rid of Jesus. I'm for religion, not Jesus. Hey, I'm for goodness, not Jesus. Hey, the church is great, not Jesus. Get rid, eliminate Jesus. So they turn to him and say, the only thing we asked you to do was shut up about Jesus. And you blatantly disobeyed. You went right out and did exactly what we told you not to do. What do you got to say about it? Now, Peter, in verse 29, begins. We don't have everything he said, I'm sure of that. But if you were to come to me and say, I want to know how to construct a sermon. Sermon construction. I would take you to verse 29, 30, 31, and 32. Because it is a perfect sermon construction. He starts with an overall, what I call, proposition. Which is the whole sermon reduced down to one sentence. In other words, everything you're going to say in this sermon, you squeeze it down to the big idea, the theme, the proposition, the whole sermon in one sentence. And most people wish we'd give the one sentence and shut up, but we never do it. Peter does that. Look at verse 29. Peter and the other apostles answered and said, we ought to obey God rather than men. That's the overwhelming, overall. That's the umbrella. Everything he's going to say comes under that. It's an explanation of that. It's tied into that. We ought to obey God rather than men. And folks, think about it. Everybody agrees with that. If there is a sovereign God someplace who has created everything that is, I probably ought to listen to him rather than the stupidity of your head. Thought there'd be an amen. I mean, that makes sense. I mean, if you go to a Buddhist, they're going to say, we ought to listen to God rather than men. I mean, everybody, every religion believes that. Anybody who has any sense of a sovereign being, a person, a God above us, would agree with that, that our culture should not dictate to us, that the God who created us should dictate to us. In fact, it's really interesting in the passage as you go on, and we're not going to deal with this, but if you go down to verse 33 and towards the end of the book, this respected teacher of among the Jews, Gamaliel, gathers this council together, puts the apostles outside, gathers them together, and looks them in the eye and says, guys, you don't want to mess with this. And he gives two illustrations. He says there was this guy who literally went out and had a following of 400 men and had quite a little movement going on. And what did you do to it? You didn't do anything to it. You just left it alone. And what happened? He died and the 400 men fled. They went away. He brings up the subject of a guy by the name of Judas who was from Galilee. And he had a strong following. And what happened to him? Same thing. He dropped dead. Hey, the followers all dissipated, and that was okay, and the whole thing went away. So if this is of God, don't mess with it, because you won't win. If it's not of God, it'll go away. So see, Gamaliel even said that to them. And they all agreed, we ought to obey God rather than men. The Sanhedrin believes that. The apostles believe that. Everybody believes that. We ought to obey God rather than men. Well, if that's true, if everybody believes that, what's the problem? Oh, here's the problem. What is God saying? Y'all obey God rather than men. Okay, what's God saying? We don't agree on that. You realize, don't you, that if you, whatever you think God is saying, you can find a church that will tell you he's saying that. If you aren't confused about what God is saying, go home and watch TV. The TV preachers, you will be confused. See, what is God saying? See, if you believe that homosexual lifestyle, same-sex marriage, and the sexuality, if that's okay, you can find a church that will tell you that's what God is saying. If you believe that you can sin every day and disobey God and still be a Christian and go to heaven, you can find a church that will tell you that. See, if you believe in once saved, always saved, you can find a church that will tell you that. See, whatever you want to think God is saying, you can find a church that's going to tell you that. So what does God say? Peter says, look at verse 29. We ought to obey God rather than men. What does God say? Peter says, God, oh, you got to get this. God, the Trinity God, the Trinity God, think of this, the Trinity God opened his mouth and spoke. And you know what came out? Jesus. Oh, you didn't get it because you didn't stand and cheer. The Trinity God opened up his mouth and spoke. And you know what came out? Jesus. Jesus is the speaking of God. The Trinity God didn't speak ideas about Jesus. He didn't give doctrine about Jesus. He didn't preach theology about Jesus. He didn't preach information about Jesus. He didn't describe Jesus. The Trinity God opened up his mouth, and when he wanted to talk to you, you know what came out? Jesus. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then he goes on to develop that in John chapter 1 and said, the Word is Jesus, that the Trinity God opened up his mouth and spoke a word. And you know what the word was? Jesus. The person of Jesus. Now, this probably doesn't, I probably don't need to spend time doing this, but I just like to. I know you probably got this down. See, when we say Jesus, we're talking about the person of Jesus. We're talking about a real, live, functioning, individual person, an entity who has a brain and thinks, who has emotions and feels, who has a will and makes decisions. That person, that real, live person guy. Do you know God is a person? Now, you may be a philosopher, and you may want to say, well, God is bigger than person. He can be anything he wants to be. Who am I to tell God what he ought to be? He can be anything he wants to be. But as revealed in this book, God is a functioning person. He has a mind, he's thinking, he has emotions, he feels, and he has, oh, you're made in his image, you got him too. And when the Trinity God opened up his mouth and spoke, what came out? That person. Christianity hangs on that person. Not ideas about that person, not belief system about that person, but that person. In fact, do you know what it is to be a Christian? It's to have that person actually come and move through the pores of your skin and get inside your body. By the way, I'm a Christian. Why? Because I'm a nice guy. I'm a Christian. Why? Because I got two people living inside this body of mine. One teenager said, that's schizo. No, it's not. A schizophrenic is one person acting two personalities. I'm two personalities acting one. I know I'm not much, but you better look out for the left hook, brother. I'm hanging on to him, and he and I are together. And it isn't just that he lives within me, like, where does he live in you? Well, folks, I don't know where I live in me. Whether I'm down there, or I'm up here in my big nose, I don't know. But wherever I am, he is too, and we are together in intimacy and oneness. I've been trying to teach this to our guys, where we are. A lot of them have never been in church. They don't know anything about spiritual, physical, and what we're talking about. I've been trying to describe it like this. Here's a dead guy. There's his nose, there's his ears, there's his limbs. There's his... What's missing? Well, you say life. Okay. Soul. All right. Spirit. I don't know what, whatever you want to call what's missing. That's what Jesus wants to join. That spiritual, unseen, can't measure it, can't weigh it, me. Literally filled. Permeated so that person and who I am and who he is literally comes together in some kind of a merger, some kind of a all mixed up together, some kind of saturation, some kind of intimacy, some kind of oneness, some kind of where we function and literally become a new creature. I can't be that on my own. He isn't that on his own. But together we make up this new, it's called Christian. So Peter says, when the Trinity God opened up his mouth, he spoke. And what did he speak? Jesus. He spoke Jesus. The person. The actual, literal person of Jesus. Well, how do you know that? Well, verse 30, number 1. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom you murdered by hanging on a tree. See, the Trinity God opened up his mouth and spoke Jesus. And what did you say? I'm not listening to that. In fact, I'm going to take what God is saying and I'm going to nail it. And you hanged him, murdered him by hanging him on a tree. You eliminated him. Because I am not going to listen to Jesus. I'm not going to have Jesus interfering with my life. I'm not going to be intertwined and merged with Jesus. Shut him down. Don't eliminate him. Get rid of him. Hey, I don't mind religion. I don't mind a few rules. But get rid of him. Nail him. So you nail him. And you know what God, the Trinity God, did? He raised him from the dead and said, I'm not done talking. See, I'm not done talking. And he's yelling at you again. raised him from the dead. Wow. Because he isn't done talking. And he's still talking Jesus. Still talking Jesus, folks. Yelling in your ear, still talking Jesus. Well, how do you know that? Number one, resurrection. Raised up Jesus, whom you murdered by hanging on a tree. Number two, him, Jesus, God has exalted to his right hand to be prince and savior, to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Are you getting it? We have to obey God rather than man. What is God saying? He's speaking Jesus. How do you know that? Because you nailed him and God raised him from the dead and said, I'm not done talking yet. And he took that same person of Jesus and he literally exalted him to the top spot of humanity. And everything that God has ever dreamed for your life is in Jesus. Everything God wants for you is in Jesus. The whole deal of the dream destiny of your life is contained in the person of Jesus. It's all about Jesus. And everything God wanted for Adam, he now has planted in Jesus. And he's elevated him as the prototype for all humanity. He has got the top spot. We have to obey God rather than men. Well, what does God say? Opened up his mouth, spoke Jesus. How do you know that? Resurrection, raising from the dead. Number two, exaltation. Exalted him to the highest spot. Number three, verse 32. We are his witnesses to these things. And so also is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. Now, if you've thought about the verse, which probably you have not, but look at it again. We are his witnesses. And so also is the Holy Spirit. You would at first think, oh, that's two witnesses. We are his witnesses, so also is the Holy Spirit a witness to Jesus. But then he says, no, it's not two witnesses, it's one witness. Because he's given the Spirit of Jesus, whom God has given to those who obey him. So it's one witness, which is back to the merger. So folks, here's the deal. Here's the deal. God, that Trinity God, has opened up his mouth and has spoken Jesus. And yes, I nailed him. Yes, I eliminated him. Yes, I said I'm not listening. But he kept on talking. In fact, God has just pushed Jesus to the highest level of humanity, exalted him, and now wants to take the spirit, life, essence of the person of Jesus and invade my life. Literally intertwine my being. Literally weld, fuse. What's the word? Saturate. See, this is not coffee cup with coffee in it, and I'm just a shell in which God dwells. This is a total interaction with the divine. Where he and I have literally become this new thing. I can't be that on my own. He has decided not to be that on his own. And together, in the intimacy of Jesus and me, do you know what that means? I got a marriage problem. No, you don't. You got a Jesus problem. I got an anger problem. No, you don't. You got a Jesus problem. No, you don't. You got a Jesus problem. every problem I've got can be solved, will be solved, if I knew him better. My problem is, I don't know him well enough. So the goal of the whole 3 days is that we would just wrap our arms around each other and just get into Jesus and let Jesus get into us. And it'll change our world. Jesus, I haven't listened to you. I've been so stuck on my own ideas and full of my own self. To you, and you give yourself to me until we became so intimate that we functioned in tandem, we lived in oneness, intimacy took place. Would you forgive me? Would you invade my life? I confess tonight I do not know you as well as I want to know you. I get the feeling there's a new level I could go to. A new level of intimacy. There is a craving in the deep of my personhood to know you in a new way. Could that happen tonight? Our heads are bowed. Eyes are closed. Would you seek with me? Would you go after Jesus with me? Regardless of where you are in your spiritual experience, would you be willing to admit tonight you don't know him as well as you could? I'm not talking about read the Bible more, although that would be good. I'm not talking about you ought to pray more. I'm not talking about that. You ought to go to church more. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about you and the person of Jesus. I'm talking about you craving him. Talking about you becoming so intimate with him that your days are filled with him, that you don't do anything without him, that he is involved in everything that's going on, that you and him are one. Would you seek with me? Would you go after that in a new way? Would you desire that? So our altar's open. I'm going to kneel. I'm not kneeling to prime the pump. I'm not kneeling to be an example. I'm kneeling because my whole system cries out to know him more. To know him better. Could I go to a new level? Could he pull me in? would you go with me in seeking him? Be obedient.
Church of Christ.
song of response tonight. I invite you to sing about, okay, what does it have to do with me? Stephen spoke to us about this new creation. New creation doesn't look much like the old. It's been grabbed a hold by the person of Jesus Christ. Not a theology about Jesus, not a doctrine about Jesus, the person who cared enough, who loved you deeply enough to die for you. We all know John 3:16. I wonder if you know John 10:42, where Mark 10:42, where Mark is talking about how Jesus didn't come to this place to be served, but he came to serve, to give his life up as a ransom for many. And so Jesus, being fully God and fully man, came not to be served, but to serve. Then what does that have to say about us who are men, who are women? Man, how much more should that new creation look like who Jesus is instead of who we used to be? So as we prepare to respond, not by singing a pretty song, but by leaving this place and going out and being the presence of Jesus in the community in Nacogdoches, Texas, I invite you to join us in praying this prayer, that we would look less like the old and more like who Jesus is, because of the way he's loved us and the way he's served us. Let me teach you this chorus. It's real simple. Pray with me. Give us the same.
Give us, give us.
Each of the believers in this house. It's in your name we pray.